Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Welcome to this, the January meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners.
Go with it if you want.
Glad you all are here. Such a lovely night outside. We would like to begin the meeting, and we'll call the meeting to order and ask Linda Massey, Commissioner Massey, if she would offer the invocation for us.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for watching over us and keeping us safe, Lord. We just ask you, Lord, that you give us the wiseness and so that we can do what we feel is best for the county. And Lord, we pray for all our troops overseas that they will come home safe. And then also the troops that are fixing to leave to go overseas. And all these things we ask in thy name. Amen.
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 Thank you, Linda. Commissioners, we need to review and approve the agenda to include the consent agenda. I do have one small change on the agenda I'd like to offer the board, and that is under item number 8, the Family Justice Center presentation. Your agenda says that Cindy Brady, the director, will be giving that presentation, which she will, but assisting her tonight will be Judge Jim Robertson and also Sheriff Terry Johnson. So there will be three people in that item if that suits the board. Are there any items on the consent agenda that would that a commissioner would like to be pulled?
I'm good. I make a motion we go with it as presented.
Are you making a motion to approve the agenda to
yes.
include the consent agenda as presented?
Yes.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Tim. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? The agenda is approved with that one change. We do not have any public comments tonight. At this time, we'll see if there are any opening commissioner comments. Hearing none, we now have the opportunity and pleasure to receive our annual financial report, which is presented by Martin Starnes and Associates, and presenting on their behalf is, I'm sorry, I did not get your name.
I'm Crystal Waddell.
Crystal, welcome to you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me tonight. Again, my name is Crystal Waddell. I'm from Martin Starnes and Associates, and we prepare your annual financial statement audit. So I'm here tonight to discuss your results from your 2011 audit. First of all, we issued an unqualified opinion. An unqualified opinion means that there were no material misstatements in your audit report. And we would like to take this time to thank Amy and Susan and the entire finance department for all of their hard work and cooperation during our audit process. A little bit about our audit process. Our firm audits over 130 governmental entities across North Carolina. So for us, this is a year-round process. We start as early as February. We start risk assessment, doing planning procedures, and importing trial balances. Then we come out to visit Alamance a week in the spring or early summer, and we perform what we call interim fieldwork procedures, where we concentrate on your internal controls and do some grant testing. And then we come out a week in September and perform our final fieldwork procedures, where we concentrate on where your year-end balances fail. Now the important stuff. Here's your general fund summary. You can see that revenues came in at $120 million. That was a $120,000 increase from 2010. And the revenues fluctuated across the board as far as revenue source. Your property taxes were down $582,000. Sales tax were up $2 million. Your beer and wine tax increased $162,000. Restricted intergovernmental, which is your federal and state grants, decreased by $3 million. And your sales and services increased $1.5 million. And this was primarily due to the cell tower fees. There was some increased customer fees and more diligent collections there. Your expenses came in at $126 million. Expenses were down $370,000 over prior year. And this fluctuated across departments. Your general government function was up $283,000. More specifically, within that general government function, your tax administration department was up $300,000. However, in the past, you had a department for the revaluation department, and as part of some restructuring, that was taken this year and consolidated into the tax administration department. So that explains that increase. MIS was up due to some new capital lease payments for capital leases for county equipment. Public safety was down $957,000. The sheriff's department decreased around $1 million. Economic and physical development was down $325,000. Human services was down $1 million. And I mentioned earlier that your federal and state grant revenue was down. So as those grant sources decrease, the cost of operating those programs also decrease. Your cultural and recreation department was up $542,000, and your debt service also increased around $700,000. Debt service was up because in 2010 you issued $5.9 million in recovery bonds. That first debt service payment became due in 2011, and I believe that was $590,000, and you also issued some qualified school bonds in 2011 and actually paid a debt service payment of $260,000 in 2011. Education was up $356,000, and more specifically, the allocation to Alamance Burlington school system was up $500,000. Your top three expenses are education at $38 million, followed by human services at $32 million, and then followed by public safety at $27 million. Fund balance. In 2011, there was an accounting standards change called GASB 54, and GASB 54 redefined how we present fund balance in your audit report. So you will no longer simply see in your general fund unreserved and reserved fund balance. You can now have a five potential categories. You can have non-spendable, which are items that are not in cash form, such as prepaid items or inventories. You can have restricted fund balance, which are items that are earmarked by an external third party. Committed and assigned fund balance are internal designations that you, the board, have restricted internally for a specific purpose. And if it doesn't fall within the top four categories, then it then becomes unassigned. Alamance County's general fund balance came in at $19 million. That was a $4.4 million decrease. Revenues came in under expenditures around $5.7 million. Also included in the change in fund balance were $1.6 million transfers in from other funds and $1 million transfers out to other funds. Also included was $725,000 proceeds from capital lease issuances. Available fund balance. The Local Government Commission defines available fund balance as total fund balance minus your non-spendable minus any stabilization by state statute. The Local Government Commission uses this calculation to compare your fund balance to other counties of your size. So here's the county's available fund balance. You can see the total fund balance of $19 million minus your stabilization by state statute, and that gives you available fund balance of $13 million. That was a decrease over prior year, $2.1 million. The Local Government Commission then takes that 13.7 available fund balance and divides it by your general fund expenses to get a percent, and they call it the available fund balance percent. And again, it's just a tool to compare your fund balance to others. And your fund balance percent was 10.9, was a decrease over prior year. The Local Government Commission has a recommended 8% fund balance available. However, it's not required. It is a recommendation. However, as your fund balance slowly approaches the 8%, you may get a unit letter from the Local Government Commission explaining their concerns and wanting you to respond with a corrective action plan. How do you intend to increase your fund balance in the general fund? I'm going to move now from the general fund to your enterprise fund. Here are the landfill results. You can see that your operating income was $143,000, and this increased over prior year around $100,000. At the budget level, expenses decreased by $12,000. Most of that $100,000 increase in net income, however, relates to your post-closure cost, and those are federal and state requirements relating to environmental costs to monitor and close that landfill. And that current year expense decreased by $300,000, and that's a full accrual number, so it doesn't affect your budget. However, it is included in these results. The bottom part of this slide explains your net assets, and net assets for an enterprise fund are the equivalent of fund balance. So you can see your unrestricted net assets were $5.6 million, and your total net assets came in at $18.7 million. So net assets increased by $170,000. I don't have a slide for it here, but I do want to talk to you about your internal service funds. The workers' comp fund is in good shape. The expenses, excuse me, premiums were $900,000 and expenses came in at $449,000. So that was a net income of $454,000. However, when I look at the employee insurance fund, it's my understanding in order to cut costs in your general fund, the board decided to decrease the amount of deductibles you were charging to your general fund departments in 2011, and as a result, in 2011, your employee insurance fund took a loss. Your premiums came in at $5.8 million, and your expenses to run that fund was $8.1 million, which is a loss of $2.2 million. So we would recommend that the board perhaps take a look at those rates going forward in the future. And that's all I have tonight. Do I have any questions?
You're familiar with other states as far as, don't you audit areas, other states?
We only audit in North Carolina.
Oh, okay. I thought y'all.
But several governmental entities.
But do you know by chance what the other states have as far as requirement or suggestion for fund balance?
I don't know of other states. Again, in North Carolina, it's the 8. Recommended 8%.
You don't know what other states
might
do
there? I do not.
There. Okay, I was curious.
Crystal, can you go back to the available fund balance dash general fund slide, please? Stabilization by state statute item that you have pointed out there. I see with the number, and I see the title, but what is that really? What makes up that $5.3 million?
That is a state mandated calculation, and it is your liabilities at year end in your general fund minus your deferred revenues plus encumbrances.
So that number is an accounting calculation based on our June 30th snapshot at that time?
It is.
Well, and I guess the reason I think we need to understand a little better is you know, we're looking at our report and the fund balance went down by $4.4 million, but the available fund balance only went down by $2 million. So what does that tell you as far as the state of our finances?
Total fund balance did go down $4.4 million. Stabilization by state statute at 2011 came in at $5.3 million. This calculation's driven solely on, not solely, but primarily on that stabilization by state statute. In 2010, your stabilization by state statute was $7 million. And so your stabilization by state statute decreased in 2011, which made your available fund balance decrease less than your total fund balance decrease. So it's all really where your balance sheet for the general fund fell in, where any liabilities or deferred revenues and encumbrances fell in at year end. And that could be, you know, outstanding invoices at year end.
Well, I was thinking we could end up, we could actually manage that a little bit.
You can.
Depending on how you close out the year, is what you're saying. Yeah.
And the, exactly, on what's outstanding. Right. So then go on to the one where you calculated the 8% or the 10.9%. Well, yeah, that one. Well, what was the division that gave us that 10.9%? Do you have that, Crystal?
It was that 13.7 available divided by
that year's revenues, total
expenses.
Revenue.
If you look on page 15, total expenditures of $126 million.
Okay, so it's the general fund?
It is, general fund only.
Okay, well, while you're on page, right there, if you'll turn to page 17, and I guess, Craig, this is a question for you, but are there any line items there that this is where we're comparing the actual, what really happened in 2011 with the final budget? Are there any items there that particularly stand out that we need to comment on? Crystal told us, you know, what was there in terms of property tax and so forth, but where are you, Craig?
I guess it just revenues have been down. It's just the trend, and one of the things that, you know, we tried to adjust some in this year's budget as well is we lowered revenue projections. We've lowered expenditures. Again, I think if we look at this and look at where we are, it's not an expenditure-driven process that we have because we've cut expenditures. You know, if we look at our expenditures back in, I think it was 08, we had about $132 million worth of expenditures. And now we're at 126 million. So it really goes back down to this budget shortfall is revenue driven, and it also, if we look at our fixed costs that we've added as far as our debt service, that will eventually be about $1.1 million or $1.2 million in new debt service we've added over the last couple of years. So we've added some fixed costs with revenue going down. And is that kind of a fair?
It is. Federal and state grants are down statewide. Sales tax, although you saw an increase in sales tax, is still not where you were
right
3 years ago, and that's consistent statewide. And that's a big hit to everyone's budget.
Only because it's a large item. Craig, what's the difference between the category of revenue, the local option sales tax, which I think we all know what that is, versus on down there's a large item, sales and services. What would constitute that?
Sales and services is EMS, jail, services that
those
we provide
fees
as a county, and revenue that we receive.
Okay.
Those are the two largest sources.
Well, on the enterprise fund, Greg Thomas is here, so congratulations to you and your fund.
Yeah.
It's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
Any other questions for Crystal? I believe the board needs to formally receive and accept this audit. Is there a motion to do that?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Is there a second? Eddie, any other comment or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Crystal, thank you very much.
And
thank you for working with Amy and Susan and everybody, and understand it was a really, really smooth process.
My pleasure, yes. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you. Next item on our agenda is the Family Justice Center presentation. At this time, we'd like to welcome Cindy Brady, the director of the Family Justice Center, who will begin and pass the torch to Judge Robertson and the sheriff.
Yeah. Thanks for letting us come out tonight and talk to you and give an update. Tell you what's been going on. There's a lot happening.
Thank you.
I have some more to read. As Tom said, my name is Cindy Brady, and you know, obviously we're here because we think this is an important topic, and in fact in the 2011 community assessment, it was one of the four top social priorities was in fact domestic violence, and so it still is on the list and still an important issue to lots of people in our community. The short time I've been there, it's been really interesting. One of the things we've really got going on for us is all the people that are involved. with this effort. And there are tons of people who volunteer. I've got a group back here that came out to support me. But that's the advisory board. And so that's the guys that, you know, the policy wisdom and the advice and who get together and really drive what's happening at that center. And you can see there's, you know, it's everybody from the police department, to the sheriff's department, to the county. The Victims Advocacy Council, and again, it's a diverse group, and that's the group where from where all these ideas came, and the Family Justice Center idea was born, and they drive. They're the folks that make it happen, make the big things happen, and then you've got the on-site partners who are making it happen every day. And I could not let this pass without recognizing the electronic 50B logistics team, because that's just a thankless, tedious job. They are just having to dig down and figure out how to make this manual process work. In talking to other people, we've got a group coming from Hampton, Virginia Friday, and it's just a very small core group. And part of the success here is that everybody's on board and involved. And so I appreciate that. I have a couple of volunteers that are helping me out tonight. They've already been introduced, and I always try to, we travel in a herd, and so I drag them out wherever I go with me, and so I'm going to turn it over now to Jim Robertson.
Thank you. Commissioner Mann.
We welcome you.
Commissioner Sutton, Commissioner Massey, Commissioner Lashley, Commissioner Boswell. I again appreciate an opportunity to speak with you. My little part here is to kind of give you some historical context for this Family Justice Center, which is once again a shining star, I think, for Alamance County. I just noticed a recent article in the News and Record, which talked about Guilford County trying to start something, and the only one in North Carolina was right next door in Alamance County. And I was proud.
Yeah.
I was just very proud about that, and I thank you. This effort started, the effort that led up to the Family Justice Center started in about 2002. A group of folks got together with this idea, continued on through some conferences and things like that in 2003. In 2005, we had sort of a retreat at Fabulous Fort Fisher. I don't know if you've ever been to Fabulous Fort Fisher, but it's basic. And
didn't the Indian program go there? Was
how? Exactly. In 2005, at Fort Fisher Retreat, we decided to try community dialogue, find out what the community wanted, not just what this group wanted, but what the community would want. And so in 2005, we in fact did have a community dialogue. It was held out at it was either Twin Lakes or ARNC. Twin Lakes. And We didn't lead anybody in any direction, and the community, I mean, we invited folks from hospitals, schools, I mean, just a real broad cross-section, and they voted the number one thing to do to help victims of domestic violence and child maltreatment was a Family Justice Center. This was initiated under President George Bush's leadership, on a national level. And so that was the number one thing. And so we kept working with it because we recognized that it was a large undertaking. And eventually I made a request on behalf of the group to this board asking if you could help us realize this dream of a Family Justice Center. And in August 2008, you did just that with a commitment to renovate the Martin Street building. Allow it to be used as a Family Justice Center, among other things. The Family Justice Center opened in July 2010, and we've been busy over there ever since. This program, on a personal preference, this is an essential component to our core efforts to address domestic violence in our community, and it's impacting to the community at large. It is an outstanding facility. It is just not only beautiful, but it's so functional. And that's by any measure, it's an outstanding building. And you can imagine that an effort to sustain or efforts to address domestic violence prevention is intensive and requires sustaining. I mean, I'm an old guy. I'm not going to be around a long time. No, I'm not casting on anybody else. I'm just saying I'm an old guy. And I want it to last for my children's lives and their children's lives, this concept of protecting the most vulnerable in our community. The group there now is really doing a good job as stewards of the investment and the commitment you make, but they do stand on the shoulders of folks who came before to got this building renovated, got these programs started, and have made an impacting difference in the lives of families. You've seen the list of folks who are involved in this whole process. Now, the benefit of that is that we're not working in silos. This facility helps us come together, lots of crossing, lots of disciplines, and to have a joint effort to address domestic violence and to protect victims. The Family Justice Center is a focal point for many meetings, many trainings, for services to victims. And it's a focal point for keeping that large group of people energized and focused on the issue of domestic violence. I can tell you, without it, it wouldn't happen. It would not happen. And the level of is tremendous here. And we're going to enhance it soon with electronic filing of those domestic violence protective orders from the Family Justice Center to the clerk's office, to the courts, and so that victims really can stay at the Family Justice Center without having to leave. We've sought out other resources, financial resources, to help us get that electronic component done. This will dovetail with law enforcement in order to provide computer services to them so they know what the latest and most updated orders, protective orders would be. It will save them time, money, resources, which is something I know we're all wanting to be better stewards of. So it has led to better screening of domestic violence cases, which means we'll have fewer cases, but they're the real cases, instead of having a lot of folks just blatantly take out protective orders or attempting to take out protective orders and bogging down the court and bogging down the sheriff's department and bogging down. Better screening, better efforts, and essentially in the final analysis, I hope we'll show to you and prove to you that we're good stewards of that commitment you made. I appreciate it. I want to turn that back to Cindy for just 1 second.
Thank you, Judge.
Thanks.
Thank
you. Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about what we've been doing. And so the numbers that we report to the county every month are number of clients served and the ex parte orders issued. Now, the handout you got with your agenda said ex parte orders requested, and it should have said issued. But that is a temporary protective order, and that's currently what we are talking about. And you can see that the numbers are, in fact, decreasing. I'm trying to make the little pointer work. Oh, well. But you can see that the numbers have decreased, and that is due to better screening and diversion of 50C protective orders to the magistrate's office. And so what I've come to realize since I've been there, it's not about somebody coming over there and getting a protective order. It really is trying to figure out how to make the services efficient and effective and appropriate so that it's not bogging down every step of the way. And so I think as the electronic filing is in, as well as a court navigator program we're going to ask for a grant for tonight, that's going to eliminate the steps where the woman has the opportunity to say, or the victim has the opportunity to say, am I making the right decision? This is too hard. I can't believe I have to go through all this. And every time you do that, you make it more efficient and you make it more appropriate for that person. Female, male. I think some people are surprised that 20% are male, but that's been pretty consistent. The highest category is the 25 to 59, but we really need to look at the 60 plus. Also, in the community assessment last year, elderly abuse doubled since 2010. There's been a huge increase, and that's something we've got to look at to see, you know, outreach or to see what's going on there. Relationship to the victim, again, looking at these stats, I was sort of surprised that the dating relationship was as high as the spouse or intimate partner. But that's an opportunity to go to maybe that younger group and maybe do some outreach or interventions so that you don't end up with a group of victims who engage in or in abusive relationships and stay there. So that was interesting to me. I'm a data geek, though, so I like all that. And then Caucasians are the group that uses our services the most. So that's it. We're working on sort of refining the data we collect and rate of dismissals, arrest rates, and just different things like that, and trying to figure out what makes sense and trying to gain some consistency. So with that, I'll hand
before,
it over to
before
you.
Before you go, I know you haven't had that much time to develop the stats, but do you feel the economy is having an adverse effect on people's relationships, especially in that elderly category? I would have thought the economy might have a lot to do with that. What do you think?
I don't know the answer for that.
I know it's kind of crazy.
On the spot. It's not so crazy. It actually is not so crazy. And if you talk to Dina Joy at Crossroads, she will say that the economy and people being at home more because they are unemployed is causing an increased rate in their business. And of course you see ours went down.
Commissioner Sutton, I can see that stress not only in this civil end of the restraining order, but also in the criminal courts where people just go directly take out the money. And I think you're exactly right. That stress from the economy and their folks are just more irritated at one another and blame one another, and then sort of fight over the limited resources. But and that's anecdotal on my part, but I think that's what we're finding in both those.
I wouldn't think it could help, that's for sure.
Well, domestic violence is about power and control, right. But if people are in the home together because they're unemployed, there's just more opportunity for that to get out of, you know, go over the top. Yeah. So it makes sense. Has anybody got any other questions? All right, I'm going to pass it to Sheriff Terry, and then I'll be back, actually.
Good evening, Commissioners. It's great to be before you tonight. Let me tell you something. When I became sheriff in 2002, one of the first things that I noticed was the amount of domestic violence we had in Alamance County. And be honest with you, becoming sheriff for a few months, I looked back and saw that the number of homicides that we were having was, in fact, domestic violence related. And thanks to some of these other folks that's on the board, they come to me and say, "Sheriff, we need to do something." I went out and met with them in New Orleans, Louisiana, and listened to what was going on at a conference out there, and made up my mind that we were going to have a domestic violence unit at the Alamance County Sheriff's Office, because our call response and the number of calls we were receiving domestic violence related was running us to death as far as patrol division and investigation. And what they're saying tonight, you know, while looking at numbers involved in any project, you look to help to evaluate that project. When you've got an initiative going and the numbers go down, it's usually saying that things are really working in that particular project. The Family Justice Center in Alamance County is similar, but a little different. We cannot ever measure the ability of one to stay out of a domestic violence relationship. And no program can tell you when a person will wind up a statistic or dead. In Alamance County, 75% of our homicides since I've been sheriff has been domestic violence related. The good thing is, this past year, we had one homicide in Alamance County, and it was a drug-related homicide. Before, we were having 3 to 5 constantly a year, and 75% of them were domestic violence related. Here in Alamance County, we want to ensure that the victim has the easiest path to navigate through our system so that they will not give up and just become another statistic for law enforcement. And that is either beaten or dead. And you folks, you the commissioner, should feel a sense of pride in helping us develop the Family Justice Center in Alamance County. Because where you realize it or not, and where I realize it or not, you folks have helped us prevent fatalities, I think, here in the county. And I sincerely mean that. With all of our efforts, many lives will be saved. And our agency will not have to go to the same houses over and over to see battered spouses and crying children with no places to go. We have honestly had spouses run their spouse from the Alamance County courtroom after a judge delivered a decision into the sheriff's office chasing them. Domestic violence. That's how bad it was. We are seeing a big difference right now. I'm not going to say our calls have gone down tremendously. They have some. But the one thing about it, when we show up now on a domestic violence call, that victim knows that they have a place to go and be able to follow the procedure without having to run from Burlington to Graham to the courthouse to the clerk's office. They know that this county will be looking after their best interests. And that's what these people do, sending them at the Family Justice Center. And I am very proud to be a part of it. And I want to thank you commissioners for allowing Alamance County to be the first Family Justice Center in this state. It says something about this board and the people here in Alamance County. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Yeah. I told Susan I hate to mess that up with coming back up with this, but thank you, Terry. Part of the presentation tonight is you have a handout for a grant request in your packet for a volunteer court navigator program.
What you passed out, right?
No,
it's in our regular package.
I can't remember where it was, but it's, I remember.
It's just a piece of paper.
On the agenda.
Like this.
Yeah.
Number eight.
It's one sheet.
I'm getting there.
I've shuffled this all day long.
Do you have
there
it?
There it is. There it is.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it got pushed to the back.
I had to move all the stuff. All our stuff in the back. So one of the, as the new Family Justice Center director, I went and observed in court, and one of the reasons that victims dismiss is just, I hate to say a lack of support, but a lack of support and the inability to have enough bodies to be in court, support the victim, help them navigate through the system. The electronic 50B process is going to take care of the first part of that for the temporary order, but they've still got to go to the full hearing. I would go and sit and watch victims just wig out because they're there by themselves. The abuser's got their entire family. There were several women that just didn't come back after lunch. And I've talked to victims, and one just said to me, she said, if I had not had support from someone, I would have never gone through with it. And again, it's eliminating the opportunity or chance for them to go, I can't do this. It's too hard. I'm not sure I'm doing the right thing. So Lynn Russo, the Director of Family Abuse Services, and I sat down and thought about this, and she certainly has court advocates, but again, you could never pay enough bodies to do this. But you've got a guardian ad litem program for children. So why couldn't a volunteer court navigator person work for this? So the Governor's Crime Commission has a grant opportunity and suggested that, especially given the 50B, electronic 50B, that I should consider applying. And so this is my request to you to
to apply for this. There's no county money. You can do an in-kind match, which we can certainly get with Lynn's salary, supervision, and the office space. And so I don't know if you have any questions about that or not.
Questions for Cindy? So you are looking for a motion that the board approve the authorization for you to request this grant, and you said there will not be any county money involved, but the in-kind cash, the in-kind contribution would be of what form? Would that
office
come from
space.
The county? Which we already have.
We're already
right.
Supplying most of that.
Right.
So every what we're already doing, you can credit toward yes. our down payment, if you will.
Yes.
Okay.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second that.
Motion by?
I motion.
Linda,
motion.
Second by Eddie.
Cindy
to pursue the grant.
Well, we're going to hire the we're going to hire this person before we get the grant?
No.
Okay.
No, you see the timeline, June. No, we won't.
That's what I'm concerned about. That's no, the concern
no, no, no.
I have.
No, the grant is due January 31st, and the grant period is July 2012 to June.
That we hire that person only if we
get the grant, right?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Bill. Is there other questions, concerns? We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Cindy.
Thank
you, Judge. Sheriff, thank you very much.
Yep.
Item 9 on our agenda. I'd like to welcome Gary Cole with the Judicial Services Coordinator, going to provide a summary of judicial services. Gary, welcome.
Thank you. Good evening. Appreciate the opportunity to speak with you. Next Tuesday, I'll be out of here. I'm retiring.
Yeah, I think I saw that somewhere.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Congratulations.
And I wanted
sure.
to come and give you folks my farewell speech, more or less, but also just to give you an overview of the Judicial Services Department. As you know, Judicial Services will no longer be a county department after July 1 of this year. But I wanted to give you a little bit of a history. We came under the county in 2005. When mental health reform was going on and programs were being encouraged to divest services. And very fortunately, the county at that time chose to take us on. Let me give you just a little bit of a history behind this, because it didn't start in 2005. Actually, in 1978, I was hired by John Moon, the area mental health program, to be pretty much a one-man court liaison. And that was in response to a lack of a coordinated effort aimed at assessing offenders with substance abuse and mental health issues, hooking them up with services, and providing case management to hold them accountable for following through with that. In 1990, the efforts grew somewhat into what became known as a Judicial Services Department under mental health, and we were had four staff at that time. None of this, obviously, with the assistance of the judiciary and the treatment community, we were able to identify resources that could intervene in behaviors associated with criminal activity. The move, as I mentioned, to the county at the time when mental health was divesting services was primarily at the request of the judiciary to avoid disruption and fragmentation of services. At that time, what we saw was other counties were, as they divested, you were getting pieces just going here and there, and there was really not a whole lot of coordination of that. Again, fortunately, the county took us on. This unusual arrangement soon became envy of other programs. We would go to conferences and other places, and they would say, you have this kind of coordinated effort and this relationship with the county. Over the past 10 years, Elon University conducted 5 recidivism studies, and we beat the socks off of the rest of the state of similar programs as far as showing lower recidivism rates in Alamance County. So that's something we should be all should be proud of. None of the accomplishments that we have seen over the years could have been done without the hard work and cooperation of the staff that I've had the honor to work with the court officials, of course, and our community corrections officers and all other county departments. We just couldn't have done any of it. As mentioned last summer, there were some decisions made that this would be a better fit under the private realm. There have been some discussions. There were some early discussions with PBH, and after a while it was obvious that they weren't interested in taking lock, stock, and barrel. So what we have done is try to find homes for each of the services. Effective January 1, Coastal Horizons, which is a private nonprofit agency out of Wilmington, assumed the task portions of what we did. Now, Judicial Services did more than just task. Task was the evaluation, the referral, and the case management piece for offenders. They've taken that on. They're on the ground now working, trying to get their feet wet on that. At this time, it appears that most of the other services provided will continue in one form or another. We're not real clear on exactly where all of those are going to be right now. But I did want to say that I'm glad that the services are going to survive, but the loss of the services under one roof and under public administration does several things from my experience, from what I have seen. Creates a hurdle for judicial officials and offenders with regard to quickly and efficiently accessing services needed to intervene. And secondly, it has the potential to significantly reduce the level of public input. Chairman Manning and I had a discussion about the input and the feedback. I want to encourage you to give feedback to these entities that are providing these services, and I'm certainly hopeful that the court will also give them feedback and keep them honest, so to speak. We need to keep those channels of communication open. And finally, I just wanted to say again, thank you for the opportunity to serve all these years. It dawned on me as I started preparing for my retirement that I started 38 years ago over in the same building that I'm ending up in over here as a 4-H program assistant, which is a little scary, but things do go in circles. I also wanted to say that, and you folks know this, I'm preaching to the choir here, any organization or unit, a family unit, whatever, is only as good as the people that are involved in it and that belong to it. Few folks enter into public service with any hopes of making a fortune. They go into it, this type of work, because they're passionate about their community and its needs, and good employees are not a dime a dozen. I have seen that over my 38 years. They're a rare and valuable commodity that should be appreciated and never taken for granted. And I thank you again for the opportunity to speak to you tonight and for the opportunity to serve my community.
Gary, we appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Good luck in your retirement, and the music industry will be better off before.
I don't know about that. But thank you.
Thanks, Gary.
Mr. Chair, may I interrupt here just for a moment? I apologize. We've got a group of Boy Scouts here tonight that I think we're going to be here at the first meeting, and I think they might want to get home to watch the debate. See how we might not get able,
right,
to be able to, but can they be recognized?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, this is Troop 39 from the Macedonia Lutheran Church. Terry Autry is their assistant scoutmaster here, and there is one ugly child in this group. Well, he's my son, No, but my son Griffin is here tonight as well.
Griffin, you can get him at home.
I don't think he's ugly, but if he was, it would be because he took after his father.
But very proud, a great group of young men, and appreciate the work that Terry does, and appreciate the leadership that the boys have shown in being here tonight, and just a wonderful, wonderful group of young men.
I need to ask him a question. I used to call my daddy Poopy Deck Pap. Never knew what it meant. What do you call him?
That's a safe answer, isn't it? Well, welcome to each of you. Thank you for being here tonight. Craig, Brian is not here. Are we going to have presentation on the... Oh, you're hiding in the other room. Okay, all right, you're allowed to do that. Well, come forward. North Carolina Recreational Trail Program grant application. Brian, good evening to you. Welcome.
Good evening. Good evening, Commissioners. It's a pleasure to be here this evening. I'm here tonight to request permission from the board to apply to the North Carolina Recreational Trail Program grant in the amount of $41,000. We, if successful, we plan to use this money to develop an access to the Hall River down at the Greensboro Chapel Hill Road Bridge in south eastern Alamance County. The access, if we get the grant, we're funded, we'll use the funds to build the access in the DOT right-of-way where Greensboro Chapel Hill Road crosses the Hall River. They replaced the bridge a number of years ago and it left a footprint. We've been working very closely with DOT to be able to put this access in part of the old footprint, but it's actually in a DOT right-of-way. They will own it. It'll be their controlled interest. However, we have met with the landowner that this property abuts, and they're supportive of this effort and understand that, our desire to do it. The property is currently being used, but the situation is not very safe. If you've traveled that road, people are having to park on the road right now. So if we're able to do this, it'll make it a much safer access. The property would open up approximately 5 new miles of the river in Alamance County. We've established an access in Saxpahal, down in the village of Saxpahal. It has been extremely popular. Currently, there's nowhere legal, safe, worry-free to take out below this access. That's what this would do, would provide a place for folks to take out. And, you know, we have, excuse me, we have two river-oriented businesses in Saxpahal now. We have a Hall River Kayak and Canoe and the River Landing Inn, who make the river one of their focuses. So very interested to see that we're successful with this, too. The RTP grant does require a 25% match. However, we were, back in 2010, as we were working with DOT, we spent some funds to do some site planning. We've learned that we can claim those monies up to 18 months. So we would claim those funds that we had spent back in 2010, as well as we can put value on the work that our staff will do to help make the site actually take place. So there won't be any need for county money to go into this grant. We've run this grant by the Recreation and Parks Commission. They've reviewed it and recommend that you approve it also. But and at this time, I would entertain any questions from the board.
Questions for Brian?
Now, this is actually still in Alamance there. I mean, it's so close on that.
No, actually, the old bridge footprint is actually in Orange County. We've been working with Orange County on this as well as DOT, but the county won't hold any controlling interest in the property. The funds that will be spent are state funds too. So, so it's not like we would be going into Orange County, taking control of a site. It's a DOT property. So,
and what is the time frame?
They will announce in July, and then we have up to 3 years to spend the funds. So we'll continue to work with DOT if we're funded as we move forward with it.
You applied for several grants. Are you in a position to, not tonight, but as these grant responses come back, can you make sure we know what we get and what we don't get?
Yes. Yes, I certainly can. Fortunately, we've been pretty successful of late. You know, the ones we're waiting on right now are the ones for Cedar Rock Park. Those are the ones we're really keeping our eyes peeled on. We'll know about the first one in February, and then we'll know the second will be in March. And so we'll report to Craig and obviously come back and report to you if
that'd
we need
great.
To.
Okay.
That section of the Hall River is the smoothest section. It doesn't have a whole lot
more
of
water down in
rocky things to maneuver
right.
through.
That's it's a beautiful section. The river's quite different in that part of the county than it is from the north.
It's a great section. That's going to be a good trail.
Yes.
A good trip.
Do you have kind of an estimate of how much usage is there at Saxpahal? Because they're getting out somewhere when they get in there.
Let's see. So. We opened that in October of last year, and our December numbers indicated that the mill race paddle access had received over 11,000 visits since October. If you've been to Saxpahal, you'll know that that is a happening place.
Saxpahal is making big news.
It is. It's in the
New York Times or something.
It was in the New York Times day before yesterday and just recently in the Washington Post. And I can tell you that it's a burgeoning community. And we were shocked when we opened it and started tracking attendance to have that many visits to a very small site. But people just have fallen in love with that community, and it's
they
a very
have a lot of other stuff down there, too.
They do. Between the mill and the restaurant.
On the river, as somebody told me
only
today.
Only place in Alamance County you can get a goat burger.
That's correct, yes.
That's it.
You're right.
That's right. Well, I'd like to make
Don't knock it if you haven't tried it.
Eddie?
I'd like to make a motion that we give Brian the authorization to go ahead and apply for this grant.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Thank you, Bill. Any other questions or discussion for Brian? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you very much. And before I go, I would like to make one comment. Our staff, last week, we had a number of staff that are participating in an internal leadership program with our department, trying to learn more about county government and what the county does. I'd like to thank Sheriff Johnson. We took a tour of the jail, and most of our staff that went had never been in the jail before. And it was a great experience. I will say it was clean and well-run, and there was a real spirit of teamwork in between the people that we interacted with. So I want to thank the sheriff and thank his staff publicly. So thank you.
Getting out of the money. Thank you, Brian. And I'll just add, there are a lot of departments in our county that are certainly worth visiting. And again, I'll go back to the landfill. If you haven't been out to see Greg's outfit, it's worth, somebody calling the sheriff now, I guess. But it's worth the trip, and Greg's a good host. So we do have, and I think it's important to understand what all of our county departments do and what they're all about, and that's the best way to experience it by going there. Speaking of the sheriff, we have a budget amendment request tonight from the sheriff's office. You don't want to present that?
Didn't know nothing about it.
Greg, you want to help out here? Amy?
SCAAP grant.
Yeah, it's just the grant receipt and the SCAP.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. You want to use my paper?
Nobody told me nothing about it.
SCAP grant, which is our state criminal alien assistance program, which we get paid for housing those individuals that are sentenced in state. And nobody had given me a copy of this. It's a $40,158 of SCAP monies that will be coming in. And this money can be used only for situations in the detention center here in Alamance County.
Such as?
And we're asking that the the amount of funds that they need to be transferred to 432601 to pay for Robert Siegel for processing the SCAP application. Okay. And then the rest will remain in the budget of the Alamance County Sheriff to be used for emergencies and stuff like that. We've used a lot of times. We'll have an emergency. We don't have money in line items, enough money. We'll use that SCAP
so
money
pick
to
pick up some difference.
And it's basically money we've already received. It's just we need to put it in the right revenue and expense line items. And it requires a budget amendment.
Thank you, Sheriff. Thank you, Craig. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second? Linda? Mm-hmm. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Sheriff. Sir. Craig, do you have any reports for us tonight?
Two quick updates. Just say a quick FYI, and with the support of Judge Robertson and the work that Tim's done, we remodeled courtroom one, which is in the basement over at Civil Courts. If you remember, it was part of the facilities improvement money that we had left over. We've got that finished. The dedication on that is going to be on Monday, January 30th at 8:30. It's just a very small type of dedication. It really has made a huge difference down there. And I think we had a budget of $30,000, Tim?
The board had approved a budget, I think, of $60,000. We spent around $28,000 of our monies and then about $8,000
right.
From the district court judge's budget. So about
$36,000. Right. So all the improvements that you'll see down there, about half of what we originally thought.
I hope they got the jury box.
We redid everything.
Oh,
it's
yours.
Incredible. It really is amazing, the transformation. So, yes. But that'll be on Monday, January 30th.
8:30 next yes, Monday. Okay. What else?
And also just a quick update on our sales tax, as we were talking about budget earlier. We received our October sales tax in January, and it was up $150,000 over the year before. And that's a 10% increase over the prior year. And year-to-date, we're up almost, after audit adjustments, about 6%. So it's trended in the right way. We still got a long way to go, but we are seeing some small signs of improvement. And, just encourage everybody to
stay local and buy local and spend local.
And you are developing the actual budget calendar?
Yes, sir.
For us, and I believe we will hear most of your staff, at least initial reports, first part of April.
April 2nd, yes, sir. 9:30 at May Memorial Library.
Okay. That all, Craig?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Eddie?
Yes, I want to talk just briefly here about the PFAP, the Piedmont Food and Agricultural Processing Center, that is actually up and running in Orange County. And thanks to some members on this board that helped to fund that, it's getting a lot of usage, and they actually have some pretty large companies coming in that are relocating here to use the facility.
Good.
I say large, but they're still not large enough to build a building. So they're using this facility. One of them was Luna Pop out of Wilmington, and they have contracts with Whole Foods and a couple other places and have set up there. When this was set up, and what year was that, 07, I think, it was Alamance, Orange County, Durham County, and Chatham went in together and decided this would be an option for the counties to help start up a program. Orange County put in 50%, and I think the rest was divided between the other three counties. Well, as of today, what the steering committee is recommending is that the group move to a nonprofit setup as opposed to having to deal with the government type things that government has to do and sometimes hinder the process. And in your packet, there is a set of the bylaws that's been proposed from the steering committee there. And if you'll notice on page 6 of it, one of the things, we will still have representation on that board. And you can see kind of the breakdown of the different seats. And they want this to still have county representation, but moving into the nonprofit makes it a little easier to maneuver. It gets some of the hiring restriction that government has out of the way and some of the other things. And plus, Orange County has taken the liability role of this thing pretty much all on their own, which is nice of them to do, but they're not really excited about continuing that liability part of it on Orange County, because any of the hiring or so forth has to come through their county agencies.
Where's it located over there?
It's if you go to Highway 86 and get off, instead of going to Chapel Hill Way, you take a left and you go down to Valley Forge Road, and it's on the left. And they had the opening back in, what was it, October? I know Tom was there, and it's been a more participation maybe from the Orange County people as far as farmers, people that are coming in. This thing's set up. They can process, do bakery in-house. They can come in. If they run a food truck or whatever, they can use the facility because it's USDA approved and rated. There again, there's a liability that the county down there wants to get off their shoulders. But what it is this summer, I think we'll see more participation with farmers that want to do what you call value added by coming in, bringing their tomatoes and making a salsa to sell at the company shops or the various shops or whatever. And by having it USDA rated, that takes some of the equipment burden off of small producers or whatever. They are also adding some vegetable washing machines, just some real general stuff that farmers and people in the agricultural community can come in and use. Plus, it's a good startup company. It's just like the Luna Pop deal. You know, with success, hopefully they'll move on and open up a larger business, and then somebody will move in to that slot. And the way it works is it's leased out on an hourly type basis to use whatever part of the facility. They have freezer storage. So if you produce some kind of meat product, you can store that on site too. So I don't know that we really need a vote. It's more of a consensus on this, or
I believe it does need a vote.
Okay.
Yes, it does.
Okay. Well, I guess we're asking for the blessings of our board to move forward in the proposal of moving into a 501c3 at that level.
Well, I'm definitely in favor of that.
And Orange has already approved this. I think we would be the second county on this. And this would also separate the funding back to a nonprofit, so we don't have to be involved in hopefully any future liabilities. And if there was any revenue that was generated as well, it would stay and support that nonprofit.
As our commissioner rep, would you therefore like to make a motion?
I would like to put this forward to the board that we go with the bylaws as presented here, and that we move forward to putting it into a 501c3.
I'll second that motion.
Thank you, Bill. Any other questions for Eddie? Tim, there's a little stretch between the interstate and US 70 right there, and it's right there. It's on the north side of the interstate. And my impression was it's like the business that started in the basement, it got too good for the basement. This is its next stage. And allow it to grow.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
And then it can go on to its own facility.
Get the government out of things, and they
they make some money, right?
That's true.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Eddie.
Yes, sir.
Okay, commissioner comments? Linda?
What's this called? I do have one. I was at the Regional Partnership Workforce Development Board on Thursday, and they had a man there that did a presentation called the Burning Glass Technology. And what it is a program that goes around, and I think they have about three or four states already that are on it. And they've been to the state of North Carolina, but they have not purchased this program. It costs about anywhere from $23,000 to $50,000 a year for this program. But it's a job link program is what it is, and it allows you to go into this program. And if they decide to buy it, we did give her, Linda Parker, who is the chair of, Terry Glass is the chair, but Linda is, she's the person that keeps it going. And we did give her the authority to pursue this, but not to do it. So until we know more about it, there was a large group there from several different counties, because it's like four counties in this. Orange was there. Chatham, I think, was there. Anyway, it's several counties that belong to this Workforce Development Board. But they're going to consolidate most of the Workforce Development Boards anyway, is my understanding. But anyway, I was there on Thursday, and you all will get a copy of this on February the 6th. I think one of the girls is coming to bring you all a copy of this annual report, which we are included in it.
Right.
But, yeah, I've been going to this now for a couple of years, I think, on this board. So, but I was kind of impressed with it. But one other girl said that North Carolina already had a one. It's called NC Job Link or something. And they already have a program similar to this, what this guy was trying to present, and it's free. So, you know, you want to pay $23,000 or $50,000. But anyway, I just wanted to give y'all a heads up on that, that I did go to that, and we may hear back from that.
Thank you, Linda. Are there other comments?
I just got a real brief one. I put a packet in on desk there. Some of the North Carolina DOT projects that are going on have been completed. That was from the Burlington Graham MPO. And we had a meeting last Tuesday, and one of the things that we're working on in that group is the setting up of the boundaries. For some reason, Durham Chapel Hill has moved, wanting to take over part of Mebane. And Mebane really wants to be inclusive into the Burlington Graham MPO instead of ending up part being in two different MPOs. And the state is working, Mike Fox from the state, they're going to have another meeting and then bring it back to our board at the Burlington Graham meeting, and we're going to look at it. But they're trying to take care of this overlap. And Mebane, the biggest issue is in the new Eflin area, going towards Eflin, I guess, where they put some infrastructure, Mebane did. They want to make sure that they just want to be in our MPO here in Burlington. Graham is, instead of having to be in part of two MPOs.
I would think between Mike Fox and Mike Mills, we can make that happen.
Well, and that's it. And they're going to, Mike Fox is going back to the state because that's kind of a state run type thing anyhow, and pretty much take the request to the board back to them to make that happen. MPO being the municipality planning for all the roads and structures and so forth. So, anyhow, just thought I'd bring you up to date on that, and I'll let you know as it moves forward. I think probably February they're going to have a meeting with DOT to kind of look at that again. And what happened, Durham, Chapel Hill overstepped their bounds, basically, when they decided to draw the lines.
Did you make enough copies of that for the press on the highway?
No, I we can do that. Okay. Also, one other point that I jotted in on that, they're looking for the completion of Highway 119 to be in 2016. They're buying right-of-ways as of 2014, and the additions to NC-54 will be done by 2017. So, there you go.
54 between
Chapel Hill Road.
Where Mevin Street finished.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Yeah. Any other comments?
I wasn't going to bring this up, just now thought about it. Were we consulted at all by anybody from Coble's office about shutting the Social Security office here in the county?
Had a meeting with the Social Security director, the local county guy. I can't think of the name, the day before the announcement. And I think I emailed the board that day that I met with him.
So. I don't remember seeing it. And I'm sure you did. Yeah. What was it?
It was budget concerns. The current Burlington site was losing their lease, and they're looking at consolidation everywhere. So since they were losing their lease, it was an easy consolidation for them. And they're splitting up. Some will go, you know, the northern part will go to Reedsville. The western part of the county will go to Greensboro. There's some that will go to Durham. And I think there's even some in the south that'll go. I don't know if Pittsburgh has an office or not, but it depends on the zip code. But it was the day before the announcement came out in the papers when we were notified.
Some of those people were at that meeting Thursday, because I know Glenda Mara was there, and she was in Burlington, but we didn't talk about it.
So. With all the money they waste nationwide. To take it out on senior citizens, it's an insult to the senior citizens of this community. We got to go to Reedsville, we got to go to Greensboro. What's next?
I agree with you, Tim.
I'm excited. It's sad. And somebody. Well,
and the comment was made that they can use internet, but a lot of seniors don't use internet. So, I agree.
Is it over? Is there no way to protest this?
It's over. I think they've let the lease gone out. They've already made the moves. But it's a done deal.
It's a done deal.
Craig, I meant to ask you earlier on the audit presentation. Can we get this audit in its entirety on our website?
Yes, sir. I've talked to Amy about that, and we will. That's our plan right now, is to make sure that's on the website. Yes, sir. Do we have a date?
We probably can get it after
tomorrow. Okay, we'll try at least in the next couple of days. Yes, sir.
Are there any other announcements? I'd like to close just a little bit differently, since we do have a group of special guests. This is out of the ordinary, but would you all be willing to, as a part of our dismissal, to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance? Please. Let us stand.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, guys.
Hooray!
Thanks for being here. We're adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.
Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioner's website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.